Yes.
Very happy to see all of you here, and it's an honor that you come to the time to join for such a, I would say, special and quite magical lecture and event. Today you'll be, I would say, Indian, the first Indian in history, who is from the 20th century, who will discover this knowledge, both on the English language and in India. This lecture was never given, this information doesn't exist, and you will be one of the first who will get the opportunity to know how to use this magical tool for your own personal benefit, development, and of course, problem solving. So, before I'll start to speak and share about Amanita, maybe in two words of introduction, my name is Vadim, I come from Estonia. Estonia, it's a very small country in the north. All of the population of my country is 1.3 million people, or 13 lakh people. So it's a country that is on border with Russia and Finland and Sweden. So I come from the north, and in the north we have such, you know, winters when we have only 3-4 hours a day the sun. The rest is darkness. But when on the opposite in the summer, we have the sun goes down like almost 11-12 p.m., but it rises already like 3 a.m. So you don't even see the stars. It never gets like dark until the end. So, in other words, I come from the place, let's say, where the snow was born. And there we have very old shamanic traditions. Even though I come from a country where it was destroyed during the 20th century, as we were part of the Soviet Union, and in the Soviet Union they have destroyed all of the keepers of wisdom and knowledge, all of the shamans, all of the keepers of the old Russian wisdom. The Soviet Union was a very destructive, a horrible thing towards the Russian culture. In Russia, there's a lot of cultures, but the main thing that they destroyed was literally Russian culture, Russian wisdom, like real roots of Russian medicine, and everything. So, eventually, today we will speak about a mushroom and a plant, which is from my homeland, and also you can say home culture. It will be about fly agaric mushroom, or Amanita Muscaria. Amanita Muscaria, that's the Latin name for this mushroom. In English, they just simply call it fly agaric mushroom. This mushroom you can also find in India. I have traveled, I live now in bushes, and I even found there in the mountains from the same family, but different, Amanita muscaria. They're more yellowish, or I'll say more such purplish. But eventually, this plant, this mushroom, it grows almost all around the world. You can find this plant in Japan, in Australia, you can find it in New Zealand, you can find it in China, in India, you can find it also in some parts of Africa. All of Europe is covered with it, all of Russia is covered with it, all of North America is covered with it, with their Native American Indians here. So, why is this plant so interesting, and why is it all around the world, and how come from all of the mushrooms around the world, exactly this mushroom is the most photographed mushroom. It is the most recognized mushroom. And it's the mushroom that if you take your phone and you write mushroom, it will offer you an emoji with Amanita muscaria. Do you understand how deep? So putting it simple, it's already somewhere here. It's already in our cultural DNA and our physical DNA. We feel a connection, but we don't know what. We just find it very attractive, very beautiful, want to photograph it. But yet, if you will approach a person now of science, he will tell you that it's a dangerous, poisonous mushroom. This is exactly the lie that they have developed in my head, in my mother's head, in my grandparents' head, and etc. So, this was passed on like already like for 4 or 5 generations back at my home. I don't know how it's even here. But it was a very strong attack on one of the most effective and healing mushrooms in human history. Why is it so special, and why did they try to hide it so much? So in our today's day, we have already so many interesting medicine plants. So I won't even speak about Ayurveda because it has so much, but I'll just speak of the popular medicine plants that are right now coming out. And you know, ayahuasca, many try peyote, some try Valsalaya roses, some try yoko or muscaline, or psychedelic mushrooms. Like, everybody starts to get more and more access to these ancient medicine plants, because people who have the experience, you can just see that they have changed, and they will never be the same. They will forever be more free, and they will continue to search. So imagine that, to understand how old is our connection with this mushroom, I'll try to a little bit explain about our spirituality and humanity. So if we want to study spiritual knowledge, first of all, we usually open different scriptures and books. So books, it's a type of a form of life spiritual experience that we as humans have learned to structure. So, and there are many religions, and the most oldest one, which has the best surviving ancient scriptures, is literally the Veda books. It's like literally you don't even understand how important it is. Like Indians don't understand it. But I can tell you that yes, from Muslims, Christianity, like Buddhism, Jewish sacred knowledge, like Veda knowledge is the oldest, and it is the most like structured. But what was on our planet before we have written down our experience? Before that, we had medicine plants. And these medicine plants, if we make a scientific research anthropological, then we can follow the roots of every tradition on how old it is and how old we as humans are connected this or that plant. So, for example, the plants that I told you, like ayahuasca, yoko, peyote, this tradition is about 10 to 12,000 years old. So putting simple, before, let's say, the religion, people were using the medicine plant, so very old tradition, all of this DMT and healing, let's say, medicine from especially central part of America. Psychedelic mushrooms are older, about 15,000 years is a tradition. So they were even before the other plants were discovered. But before psychedelic mushrooms was Amanita Muscaria. Amanita Muscaria, our human tradition connection with it, it's over 20,000 years. Over 20,000 years. So it was before we ever tried psychedelic mushrooms. It's before we tried all the rest of the medicine. It was almost 50,000 years before we started to write down, let's say, the scripture and structure, the spiritual knowledge. So in other words, it's the most oldest ethnical gene that is kept in our culture. We don't consciously understand it, but it's in us. That's why it's the most photographed. That's why everybody is so attracted, because all of our ancestors have used it. This is one of the paths how humans got connected with nature. I'll put it in a more simple way. Imagine that on our planet, in schools, they teach us that there are two main life forms. It's plants and it's living beings. And there's like two big differences between the behavior, the psychic, and etc. between the plant world and the living world as animals and humans. But everybody forgets that there is a third, totally untouched kingdom. It has absolutely different energy. They're the oldest living beings on the planet. They're far more older than plants. They're great more older than any of the living beings. And that is the kingdom of mushrooms. The kingdom of mushrooms is so rich as much diversity we know in plants, there's over 300,000 different plants, the same as there's more than 300,000 different animal species and living beings on the planet. Then with mushrooms, there's right now over 400,000 of species of mushrooms. 400,000 species of mushrooms. How many do you know? So, you understand? that this is just a field of knowledge that was never like deep, because if you start digging, you're gonna get very smart and very free. Because mushrooms, they have the capacity and they have the experience of everything that was happening here throughout all of this time, even before plants and humans came. And imagine that the mushroom is actually the connection point between the plants and the living. I'll give you practical examples. Like, the mushrooms are literally that Wi-Fi network which connects all of the trees and the plants. For example, now we have Wi-Fi and we can go through, let's say, the air and space to get our signals to get connected. Imagine that under the earth, when the roots come, they have their own neuron system, exactly through mushrooms. These mushrooms, they live in a symbiosis with the trees, which give them, let's say, opportunity to live. And through their connection, they put out the roots to put the mushroom roots to other trees' roots. So eventually, if you would imagine how it's under the earth, you could imagine that these trees would just put them like this, and the mushrooms is literally the network that connects all of them. So that's why from ancient times and today, if I want as a shaman to get connected to forest land and with the spirits, I go to the land and I search for the oldest tree. Because the oldest tree has the deepest roots. The one has the deepest roots, he has the more developed connection with all of them. So if I come and give prayer to this tree, that's even today people call fallen trees. Because through this tree, you connect with all of the energy and vibrations that this tree has developed through the whole history. So that's why you want to get the blessings, find the oldest tree, and get connected with him. This connection is exactly spread out thanks to the mushrooms. So this is how the mushrooms, just a very small example, how it's like in the plant world. How does it reflect in the human world, living world? Inside of all of us, every human and every animal, there are spores. Spores of mushrooms inside of us. And if you know cancer, it's literally one of, you can say, reflections of the mushrooms. Cancer, it's literally, it only exists and starts when something happens inside of the head, the biology of the person, and he allows the spores, you can say, this cancer to activate. And the person starts, like, to die from the inside. And put in simple, when the mushrooms, they not only assist for people to live, but they also help to get loose, or to let go, if it's needed. So mushrooms, they live like in trees, and this is them, they live in us, and also part of our world. And it doesn't matter, does a human understand it or not. So that's why the most profound and unbelievable experience that a person can receive is usually connected with psychedelic mushrooms. And when people consume them, they get that opportunity to get connected with everything. How can I feel that tree like so far away? How can that? All of it has the structure of the mushrooms. All of them have that energy. So by consuming them, our antenna, our head is like a brain, it's an antenna which catches signals. That's why not all thoughts inside of our head are ours. And when you increase your energy and you get connected, you can easily resonate with anything that you want, and you will feel it on a long distance. So imagine that thanks to the mushrooms, we can increase our level of energy and make it so easy to control our mind that we get the same possibilities and capacities which we had when we were like 3-4 years old. When we were small, like 3-4 years old, when we were not poisoned by the chemistry, by the bad food, by the injections, by soap or shampoo, like, we remember how strong we are. We remember a feeling of happiness that even we didn't feel it, like, for later on, for the rest of our lives, we still remember that essence. And that essence is exactly where everybody tries to come back, to that level of happiness and joy which we had at that age. But eventually, as the people live unconsciously and they're being pulled and poisoned from all directions, people seek for this happiness, and but they cannot open it simply because the body was poisoned, simply because not enough of energy. And today I gave a Russian lecture about addictions, exactly in explaining. Like, here we have a lot of people who try many different substances. I would think Goa, we can say proudly, we have here some of the most experienced spiritual travelers, which really unites all of the wisdom of the West and the East, all of the substances, chemical and medicine plants. So yes, we have here a very interesting place, and we have here a lot of experience through which we can make very good analytics. We can really like look, see what gives chemistry, what gives medicine, and where what leads. It comes to the person consumes, I don't know, plant medicine, the person consumes like drugs from the pharmacy, the person consumes alcohol, the person consumes chemical drugs. And we can make here very interesting researches and really have a very straight picture of how it is. And I can tell you, by healing people and by assisting, there's a very like fundamental thing how they fool the majority of people. And this fooling exactly starts from childhood, from which we're given, let's say, the knowledge as if chemistry is okay. That chemistry, Russian, let's say, I'll rephrase it so it sounds even more hardcore. Chemistry is oil, black oil. You understand? Oil industry. This black shitty goo, that is from what everything is made. All of the shampoos, all of the drugs, all of the health, all of the medicine, all of them made is from the same shit, that black goo. So what happened? In the 19th century, there was this industrial revolution where we have learned to make machinery, and we started to use oil, we started to build railways, we started to build cars, and eventually we started to consume a lot of oil, and then were born the new billionaires, the oil magnates. So when they were making oil, they were not only giving it for the fuel for the cars and etc., they still had a lot of shit left from the production. And then they gave it to the chemists and say, like, look at this. And they look inside and they see that oil is just nature, but it has literally almost all of the elements of the Mendeleev tablet. You know, the Mendeleev tablet of all of the chemical elements, you can say almost all of them, a majority of them, you find in this black goo. And then they thought, there's so many elements. How we can make some profit? And then they made something very genius. Like from this oil that they make fuel, they started to make medicine. They took, like, if you would go to a pharmacy at the end of the 19th century, 20th century, you enter a pharmacy, 95 to 99% of all products will be only nature products, Ayurveda. Only. If you now go to a pharmacy, I go to an Ayurvedic pharmacy and I cannot find nothing, even from the Ayurvedic, which doesn't have that chemistry inside. So now they have changed absolutely. They made, they have taught us from childhood that putting oil and using oil, this black oil in our life, it's something good. Of course they don't say that it's this black oil and we're just making it for profit. They give it to some like beautiful names and hide the names in some like E-155. Who knows what is this E-155? You understand? And even if you have, and even if you research it, you will still get such a chemistry name, which will take you like a lot of time to really to understand which aspect and impact it has on your brain, on your body, and everything. So they're fooling us in making this very complex. The more complex it is, the less people understand and the less they want to understand it. And they made understanding of our health and how our body works very complex. They don't teach it in schools, And when even they give something, they always put the chemistry. So where was that fooling point? This fooling point happened exactly in the beginning of the 20th century. So these rich people who were controlling the oil, they understood that if you want to control your nation and the people, you need to control their health. You need to control their mentality. And the easiest way is to do it through chemistry. So what they did, they have financed and educated and built medical universities. American medical universities in their majority are all built by this bloody black oil companies. And they have destroyed, killed fully the knowledge of nature and have educated stupid doctors, which were given only chemistry methods as the only way to heal. And not only that, they did. In medicine, until today, like in science, it doesn't exist such a word called soul. Imagine that in medicine and in science until today, there doesn't exist such a word as soul. Our soul doesn't exist in science. Our soul doesn't exist when you come to the doctor. Because they're not educated that there's a soul. On the opposite, there's no soul in the human. That's why when you come to a doctor, well, in India maybe they're more conscious, but typically when you come to a doctor, he only approaches you like an animal, an unconscious animal, which doesn't have a soul, which has to be not cured the disease, but it has to be just closed, stick the problem, but don't solve it. The principle is that the doctors, if they don't use the term soul, then they will never, ever, ever, ever will be able to cure a person. Never. Because any sickness, first of all, comes from the vibration of the soul. So, as we know through the Veda knowledge and through our experience, this is a beautiful game through which our soul plays through the mind. And the mind gives us the opportunity to taste this physical world and to experience all of this physically. So if we want to, if we don't know that we have a soul and that it's not controlling the brain, like this is also a thing that they don't teach in schools. Our brain is a different unit. It's totally different. Our brain is an individual separate unit. It's like a bio computer. Its function is not to serve you. Its function that your body would run the blood, that you would breathe, that your body would survive here. Our soul is like sitting in a theater, you know? Like more observing. We're thinking, we're acting, that we're conscious. No, we're only controlling like 3-4% of things that are happening. The rest is something that's, that's why it's a game. That's why it's a game. And if you don't understand that you're playing through your body, then eventually you will think and associate all of the thoughts in your head with yourself. And as a result, it is so easy to manipulate people who think that they think for themselves. That think that they're making decisions based by their own thoughts, by their own conclusions. But it's a lie. Because the brain of a person is like an antenna. It catches everything. So, if you won't control with your soul, your brain, it will not only obey you, it will in the modern reality, everything is organized like this, that our brain would be our enemy. That through our brains and our logic and emotions, we're being the strongest manipulating in doing something what we don't want with our soul or with our heart. But we logically explain why it's correct. We ignore the feeling inside, but we follow the logic and the emotional explanation why we should do it. And eventually, if a person acts how he doesn't want to, he feels unhappy, but he finds logical explanations why it's good, or why it should be like this. So, until people want to understand that there is constantly a conflict game happening inside of our heads between our soul and the brain, which was programmed by outer forces and still is being manipulated by outer forces. Until this soul won't understand this, they won't have the opportunity to grasp the control over its own body, over its own reality, and over its own life. So put it simple, that's why all of the spiritual practices, what they focus on, to increase your level of consciousness, to increase your level of control over your body, learn to observe and to see how the mind plays. You are not the mind. What did the old teacher say? You're not the mind. In the beginning I was thinking, what did they mean? But then eventually through all of the researches I understood. They were meaning that the brain is a different unit, which is antenna catching different signals, and you cannot control your antenna, then your antenna is being under control by other beings. So simple. So imagine the human avatar body can be used by different powers. They can be used as by higher forces, but in Kali Yuga time, is the lower forces. And when a person is not controlling his body is being controlled by the lower forces. So that's why in the 20th century they allow humans to drink alcohol, to use chemistry drugs, and to use chemistry medicine. But it's not allowed to eat healthy food, you know, to do fasting, to do plant medicine, to have free time and develop yourself and your consciousness. And never, nobody ever gives time for taking care of your own health. Nobody will ever ask you how you feel inside. What is your soul feeling? Because in science, in medicine, soul doesn't exist from 20th century. And if a doctor will ask you that, he might lose his working position. Because he's going outside. And if you walk outside, you will be killed by the hand that gives you the money. So eventually we're in a very such complex moment where all of the people who are approaching doctors thinking that they're healers are actually their killers. Because what happens with majority in hospitals and doctors, as for them the soul doesn't exist, eventually they're suffering much inside. Have you ever seen happy doctors? how many of friends' doctors are alcoholics or drug addicted to their own medicine? Almost all of them. So imagine you're coming to a sick spiritual person with a lot of pain inside who hates humans because nobody asks him how he feels inside. And when a person comes, which vibration can this healer bring to the person that comes? Only destruction. And eventually only what he has inside. Person can share only what he has inside. You have shit inside. People will get the same vibration if you will talk with them and don't control yourself. And here, people who need to heal need the most healing. You understand? It's sick people who are especially done sick, so they would make even sicker anybody who comes. And they are never allowed to heal the person till the end. They need to heal him like this, that he would come back. Because you cannot make profit if the person doesn't come back. You cannot control him if the person will be healthy. You cannot manipulate him and control his mind if his consciousness and his soul are in full control. So, in all of this, was organized consciously, specially, against humanity. And any plant, and any real medicine that could give freedom for the person to get his freedom of connection with the world, connecting what he wants and what brings him happiness, were destroyed. And upon all of the horrific drugs which destroy humanity, as medicine, alcohol, and chemistry drugs, they put this image of danger on nature. You understand? Totally flexing the mirror, giving doctors thinking that they're saving people, but they're killing them, giving them the understanding that they're helping to become more independent, where in truth they're fully destroying their brains and make them fully obedient to the owners. So for that reason, we have to understand that this game, it happens, and it's happening already for hundreds of years, and that's by no matter how much people will work, it doesn't matter how much they will lack, they will stay still before, they will still be slaves, they will still have to work 5-6 days a week, they will still have no health, doesn't matter how much time they spend, their children will have to work, and etc. This is slavery, and said, this is modern slavery. Slavery is when you cannot live independent, when you don't have enough of resources and you have to constantly always fight. And when you always fight and you especially do what you don't want to do, and then this small moment of peace, you just relax, but you never get the energy to understand the big picture. This is called slavery. And we live in modern world of slavery, where 99.99999% of people are all slaves. And it doesn't understand, do they understand it or not? If the person doesn't make his own conclusion, for him will be the conclusion made by somebody who is more conscious. And that's it. And pray that you have your Guruji or a shaman who would make the choice for you, so you would have a good future. Because if you don't, well, the system will make for you. And you know how the preparations work. You can see the results of their actions right now very perfectly. And this is just like 1-2% of the public appearance what they do. It is the most disgusting things to humanity. The pharmacy industry, the military in the 20th century, but this information will come out in the next 10 years. Because right now it would be just too shocking for humans to discover what is actually happening. But all I can say, as we're killing animals and treating them like animals and using them for food, for that, well, the same is done with us. But this is a different topic. So, rolling back, now we understand that they have destroyed the opportunity for people to have direct access to their soul and direct access to communication with God. Why all religions are now bullshit? They have only maybe, they have like 60-70% what is good, you know, like what is connected with the real picture. And those 30% or 20% lacking, that's the thing which totally destroys them. So rather than giving freedom to people, it creates slaves inside of them. So a small example, as we're here in India, like India, it has the oldest access to the last civilization, wisdom and knowledge. We have here technologies which are even connected with Vimana, which is flying UFOs, and technologies which allow us to break the gravity. We have in India all of the resources, all of the resources that you need, from gold, silver, oil, to all the jewelries and crystals and blah blah blah. We have the biggest population in the world, and yet, with having all of this fundamentals, India is the poorest country in the world. You understand? Why? How come? Why are people obedient? Why are people not fighting for their own land, for their own reality? Because they were fooled, and in the religion was taken out very important philosophical aspects, out of which the people will never be free, because they're afraid. The Christians, they say, you do like this, you're gonna go to hell. And so they're never able to slap or to cut off the head of the person that they don't like, or who has destroyed their family. Fear. Fear of death. Fear of doing what you feel. So this is Christianity, the same with Muslims, and the same, and in India, the main philosophical hold, what they did, the Brits, they destroyed the wisdom of Shiva is the archetype of the male energy. How do you think? Would Shiva stand on his land and look how his land is being robbed, his people are being murdered and through medicine poisoned? How do you think? He would stand and just allow it to happen for hundreds of years? Do you think he would continue just quietly to chew and continue working for this slave owner? No, never. He will never do that. You tell me, why do all Indian men do that? Where is Shiva? Where's your power to destroy? Where's your confidence for the rebellion, for that reality that you want to have? Why do you agree on so less? Why do you agree that such destruction is made on the sacred land, the sacred knowledge, with such treasure? How come you're still chewing it through? You understand? And they took away Shiva because he is a rebel. He is the one who would just kick out and organize everything that the people who are around him, his family, would live perfectly. And until Indian men won't remember the knowledge of Shiva, the woman will continue to guide India. Because then when I look on India, India is guided by women. Because all men are kids. They always run to their mothers, sisters, wives, for eternal questions. Any situation they discuss with them, any problem they discuss with them. So tell me, are you the guy? Are you Shiva? Or you're a slave of your mind and fears and you try to put everything on the wall? You understand? When I look in India, I was thinking, why it's so hard in India like to find women who are literally like slim? And then I understood. Like all of men put all of their problems, all of the situations on all women. They don't make decisions by themselves. In majority of times for any situation, even in parliament, there's a law, important law, they would gather it and go home and share everything with their family. You understand? And then the woman thinks like the man used to think. And then she gives the conclusion how it will be. And the man. And then he runs back and the parliament. You understand? But the woman is carrying all of this on her shoulders the majority of time. That's why they're tired and they eat more. This is all weight. Weight exactly of those responsibilities which the man pulls on the woman. And this is became a norm. Not a single man tries to think for himself. Not a single man tries to make an action which won't touch, let's say, the others. That he would just do how he wants. Because the wisdom of Shiva was destroyed. When you're afraid to destroy, when you're afraid to follow your path, when you're afraid to show your feelings, to put your position above the rest, how can you change anything? So that's why, this is just a small example, that in India, they took away Shiva. In Russia, they took away Amanita Muscaria. They took away from the world all of the elements which give people power to fight, power to rebel, power of not agreeing with something what we don't like. And slaves are that consciousness which agrees upon any shit what is given to them. And until humans won't learn to say no, until humans won't will have fear of destruction, destroying your fears, destroying your past, destroying that reality which you don't like and you don't agree. Nothing. You understand? So, as right now there is such a huge attack upon humanity by the pharmaceutical industry and with the connection with the financial elite, everything is focused on destroying the health until the end. The immune system of humanity. Right now, every person who are making jabs, if you already like make 2 jabs, will try to find ways on how to cure you, but this person, he his immune system is already under the control. But I'm not sure if that person would have ever the control over his health. And if a person did 3 jabs or some 4, that's it. You can let go of them. They won't have any point. Because everything is a genetical evolutional game. And eventually, those will survive, and nature wants for those to survive who have developed the most genetically, intellectually, and etc. And everything that is weak, it will fall away.
Power dynamic, basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the power dynamic things that create the conflict between, like, who will gonna move the generation towards the forward.
Exactly.
Person, the power dynamic.
They just try to get, if before that they were having control over our minds, then now they want to get the full control. If before that they were sending signals to our mind where people associated these thoughts with themselves, then now it goes to a next level. And now after people would have, let's say, the jabs together with phones, so I explained to you that our head is like an antenna. Yeah? Our brain? It's an antenna. It captures the signals from around. That's why when we're around good people, developed people, we have high vibrations. You go to some stupid party with alcoholics and drug addicts, you're gonna get that. And it's automatic. We feel it, that's how the thoughts come. So our brain is until today catching the wave. So imagine if I want to get full control until the end over the body of the person, I just need until the end to block the spine line. I just need to block until the end, let's say, the way how, in biochemistry way, the soul can have impact and control over the brain. If I block this, I don't care who is the person, how rich he is, etc. I can just like this turn off his health. I can just like this, through the chemistry and biology, fully control his consciousness, because consciousness will obey the biochemistry, what it feels inside. If you will, they will, let's say, push a button and you'll get a lot of adrenaline. Well, if you're not conscious, you will just become very angry. You'll start to kill and destroy people around you. Just very simple example. So eventually, right now, there's a very huge fight for the humans and against them. And for that reason, that it's unfair what they're doing. They're doing it very, you know, disrespectful. Like, if in the past, when you had a war, you would stand with your opponent face to face and you could make a good fight. And now they're using very tricky methods by using stupid doctors who are need to be in psychiatric hospitals. Oh, they need to heal. Using politicians who are usually were abused in their childhood and are very mentally unfit. They're not Shiva, they're usually slaves. And through, they're using the media, they're using the chemistry, they're using so many methods that we can see the result of that in the world. That people are very unhappy, many souls more and more go away and die. People have less and less control over their reality, and eventually they were winning for the last 70 years at least. Then now, because of let's say spiritual seekers, shamans, and let's say people of God, by our request, it was given the support from the spiritual world, the support from nature. And that's why Amanita would say, like Shiva, it's time for them to come back. Because it's the time of their appearance. Because, and now Shiva comes in the last moment when nobody really believes. So it will be a good surprise. The same here with Amanita. Now it's time for it to come back. It made its entrance through the culture that kept the longest the tradition. Russian culture. We started the wave about 2.5 years ago. In 2.5 years, imagine there was in Russia almost nobody. Like everybody were afraid of this medicine. Everybody knew it from childhood, but nobody tried it. And the last, you can say even just 2 years, we have now over 100,000 Russians, 100,000 Russian people around the world who have healed through this mushroom and got connected to them. So now in Russia there is actually a wave, like a spiritual wave for Amanita Muscaria. And it's hard to block it. People already see it and many people are going in. So imagine like ayahuasca in the 60s, like from opioid, from the Central America in the 60s. So, and now the time has came to share this wisdom and knowledge with all of our English-speaking family all around the world. And especially Amanita came to assist and to help for the people who are already helping themselves. Like, we're sitting here because everybody is moving his butt like himself towards the direction, the development that he wants. And that's why just imagine that for the spirits, they love to help people who help themselves. And they don't like to help people that do nothing. So simple. So first of all, Amanita will come in, throughout the next 1-2 years to the most developed and strongest people. People who have the biggest amount of life experience and stories, for them, Amanita is the most effective. Because when you use Amanita, it gives you that energy and that clearance through which you can easily reanalyze your life. You can easily dig a hole to your soul and make it a straight picture. What brings you happiness? Which game, which role you want to play in this reality? What was the first reason why you came here? And by making straight our soul, our mind loses control over us. Putting simple, you know what brings you happiness. Now, not just things up. For example, you like to help people, or you like to travel, or you like that. And when a person is doing what he loves, he feels happy. And when a person does something what his soul doesn't want to do, even if it's logically the correct thing, it still doesn't bring happiness, it still doesn't bring that change in life. And eventually, the only thing that brings real change in life is our own, let's say, feeling of happiness, and that those changes, those vibrations that happen inside. Practically, remember your hard life situation. Those situations eventually transform only when you have reanalyzed them, when you have analyzed them and you made conclusions. Like, remember, every time when you make an important conclusion about something what you lived through, exactly this conclusion, then it's as if you put it a dot and then you scenario it. And then, like, life allows you to move on. But if the person didn't analyze what he lived through, if he didn't understand which spiritual lesson I have sent myself, then life doesn't allow to develop on. It will send you again back on the same lesson, only even harder problems. And if you will again ignore it, then it will bring you back even more harder problems. Until the soul will be so shocked and the body will so in stress that eventually the soul will wake up. It will fight through the pain and seek for the answer. But, so in other words, if you don't want to suffer in such a way, just understand that by making every day some small conscious work, you can exactly exclude those unnecessary problems, those unnecessary situations, which bring us this discomfort, this pain, and this anxiety. So, in other words, or you work on yourself, or life will assist you. And or you will choose yourself the methods how you will develop, or life will send you situations in which you won't have an option. So putting simple, or you use the freedom and the time given here, or this freedom and time can be used against you. And it's good if, let's say, life supports you in your path and you're asking for it. Because if the person is not asking, he might be born and live all of his life in the service of the system, of the demons, and live in a physical body, but never experience.